E aí, pessoal, confira a entrevista com a Mariana Mazzucato, economista da University College London, que deu uma palestra durante a reunião magna da Academia Brasileira de Ciências.
Professor Mazzucato, the lecture you just gave today was entitled Mission-Oriented Innovation, Rethinking the State's Role on the Direction of Economic Growth. Could you give us a brief look on the subject?
Sure. So what I talked about was that we should have an equal ambition today in the areas around healthcare, around climate change, that we had around going to the moon. Going to the moon was a very concrete mission, but it was addressing a challenge at the time around the space race. And this mission actually required about 12 different sectors to work together, investing to solve a problem, and lots of bottom-up homework problems, but of which most failed. So the need to welcome uncertainty and risk-taking was key. But the real issue I addressed was how can we find a balance between, on the one hand, setting a direction, right? Because these missions, like going to the moon, was set by government, while also enabling the bottom-up experimentation. And I think that Brazilian society today, thinking about how innovation can be used to tackle social problems, but also in Europe, where we have challenge-led innovation priorities, really understanding the organizational, institutional structure of the policymaking process and how it engaged with actors in the private sector and in the third sector is the opportunity. But we have to go beyond ideology in order to do this. As long as we contain our understanding of policymaking as fixing market failures, as opposed to actively co-creating and co-shaping a new space, we're not going to get there.
Most people have a view of the government as a bureaucrat. What could be done to change them?
So what I tried to do in the book, The Entrepreneurial State, was actually to look at history, to look at those places and those occasions where the state, through its different types of institutions, worked together with private actors, and actors also in the third sector, to actively shape and create markets, as I mentioned before, actually required bureaucratic structures within particular types of institutions to think out of the box. So how can we create creative bureaucracies, dynamic bureaucracies, as opposed to just using the word bureaucracy to mean something bad? So what I did in the book is I looked at all the technology that's in our iPhone that actually makes the phone smart and not stupid, came from particular public institutions like DARPA with the internet, but also touchscreen display, GPS, and Siri. These were public investments, which wasn't just about throwing money at a problem, because there's also public money thrown at things that doesn't lead to innovation. This required organizational capacity within organizations like DARPA, which were public but not political, for example. They also brought people in for 5 years and told them they really had to welcome risk-taking. And they were ambitious enough to really invest across the whole innovation chain. This was not just about basic science. And so in order to dismantle this false myth, I think, of innovative business, boring bureaucracies, we have to ask a much more subtle question. What kind of businesses, what kind of governance structures within business, but also what kind of public agency, what kind of governance structures within those public agencies, and what form of collaborations do we need for the future, as ambitious as the ones that basically got us the ICT revolution? But the future challenges are also more social, not just technological. So we also need the capacity to bring together social, economic, and political objectives. But if it doesn't happen at the level of an organization, how it does its human capital attraction, how they actually welcome exploration and risk-taking, how they evaluate their public investments, then it's very hard to just talk about this as a money problem.
Yeah. You're very successful as an economist. What would you say to the young women that has an interest on this field?
I think women who, as we know, especially after the Me Too movement, but we knew that before the movement, have still quite a few struggles to battle in order to achieve parity. I think the question should not just be parity. It should be to be a thorn in the side of the side of the status quo. Yeah. So, for example, around innovation, I really think it should be women who ask, what type of innovation? What do we mean by inclusive innovation? How can we, for example, within the area of life sciences, include in the way we define innovation also questions of equity and access? And I think that women, because of their role in society, because of their role in caring, it tends to mainly be women caring at home, not just for children, but also for older people, bringing a caring perspective to this mission-oriented approach. And in fact, you know, actually thinking of what are the CARE-related missions to drive innovation, to drive investment, to drive industrial innovation strategy, it's a great opportunity. But also, we need more meritocratic structures. You know, that will help women rise up. As long as it's an old boys network, obviously, it's much harder. I come from Italy, where we have a huge challenge in terms of women really being able to have the same opportunities as men simply because of the status quo. So we need to debunk the status quo, both theoretically, but also practically.
That was so interesting. Thank you very much for the interview.